Father, bless these that learn. Learners are happy people because learning brings happiness. And we thank you that we are divine spiritual learners. And so bless us today as we learn. And all the people said, thank you. You may try to stop history and say, here's where you park. But history will not obey you. You cannot take any certain day and say history stops here. The only place where history actually stopped to start over again was Calvary. The time clock ran out at Calvary, and it went completely dead. And everything before that was BC, and everything after that was AD. History went to a standstill at Calvary. But as for you and me, we cannot stop history. It rolls on. And so we've come to that time of the year when we say goodbye to a creature called 87. How many kicked him in the pants? Oh, you did. You mean you were glad to get rid of him. How many are glad for the new year to start it all over again? All right. Well, I'm glad you're working with history because it would go ahead without you, you see. And that's the problem with history. You may stop and it marches on, and you find yourself out of step with history. In today's lesson, which is very exciting, and it's as it is actually the first lesson we've already studied in this teaching syllabus several times, but this is the first lesson in the book, and so it's nice to get to that lesson. Our world has known many beginnings. Well, it knows one every morning, and it knows one every year. It has many beginnings. Genesis 1 is the beginning of creation, which reads like this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know, I think I have gone to the wrong one. How many are going to forgive me for that? One, two, three. I opened my Bible and I had clips in both places, and I'm giving you next year's lesson. Now, that's what you call being ahead of schedule. Anybody that can do that. Well, anyway, new things for the new year. I was on page 6. Businessmen must take inventory or they won't be in business very long. How many understand that? Yeah, you don't take inventory, and that's a good sign. Your inventory will run out and you will too. And so inventory is so very necessary. So probably and possibly that we as persons should also take a spiritual inventory, maybe a moral inventory, surely a Bible inventory. Have we been reading the Word, searching the Word, understanding the Word? A New Year's time, such as this week that we are entering into, is a good time, not necessarily better than some other time, but it's a good time to take an inventory. How many do that kind of thing, do you? You don't. I'm the biggest inventorist you ever saw. Not of commercial goods, but of my own self. And I hit myself and hurt myself and have been doing it the last couple of days, and will possibly do it for the 2 or 3 days ahead of us, saying, what have you done this year? What have you shared this year? How many people received something this year from your ministry? And why didn't you do more this year? Why were you so slow this year? And I've done that all of my adult life. People find it remarkable that I go back into incidents of my life 50 years or more and precisely tell them what happened on that day. You know, you say, well, why? Because I bring it forward so often and I have a look at it and say, hey, why didn't you do better there? And That is the only way you can improve yourself. If you're satisfied with what you have done, very likely you're going to do a little less this coming year. That didn't go over too good, did it? Very likely, if you are completely satisfied with what you did this year, you won't do as well next year. But very likely, if you say, hey, I got to take up the slack, I have to improve this situation, very likely you'll do better next year. And so it all has to do, well, not all, but it does have to do with you taking a good square look at yourself and say, this is a good time of the year to look you in the eyeballs and say, what you're going to do in the days ahead of us. If you don't do that, you're not going to do much this year. I can tell you that before the year gets started. If you're just going to let the sun rise and set, and you're going to humdrum your job, then it won't be much of a great year for you. But if you look at the last year, and the one before that, and the one before that, and say, where am I headed for? What am I doing? Is this going to increase? Have I leveled off? Or am I backing up? You know, it doesn't. You know, you got to look at yourself. And that's what God wants us to do. It's a good time. A spiritual inventory should be taken at least once a year. But, once a year. A good spiritual inventory ought to be taken every 30 days at least. Some of us need it every morning. Anyway, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if any man, say any man, so don't let yourself out on this now. Any man means any man, any woman. Any man means any woman. If any man or any woman, if they be in Christ, say be in Christ. That means that if they have had a spiritual experience and they no longer live by the world, the flesh, and the devil, but they live by the power and the grace of the Master, the Lord Jesus Christ, with a new heart, a new mind, and a new nature, that they are, that old things have passed away and all things have become new. It says, if any man, all of us, say all of us, you can't imagine the people that you know, they slip through it. They say, well, that means him, that means him, that means him. It don't mean me. When God says all, it means all. And you cannot extricate yourself from that. God wants to bless you. God wants to lift you up. And God wants to help you. And if you will permit him to and get your own mind out of the thinking of it, you will have a good time. How many know that? You will have a good time. If any man, you got to have those next three words, be in Christ. If you don't, you'd miss the whole thing anyway. Being in Christ is a secret of the new man. And so if you're in Christ, that you are a new creature, a new person, a new mind, new emotions, a new creature, these old things, they've died away. The lying and cheating and all these malicious things that the devil made us do, it looked like, they have passed away. Then in our lives, all things have become new. How many have experienced that? Have you experienced that? I've experienced that. I made a decision for the Lord Jesus Christ. He received and accepted my decision. And at that moment, I stopped doing things that were bad and I started doing things that were good. And nobody could understand it. They just said, I don't see how this happened. And all of them prophesied it wouldn't last a week. Of course, they're all dead now, so I don't have to bother about that. Verse 18, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation, has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. There's no need of us saying, you know, we've never sinned and we've never done wrong. We know we have sinned. We know we have done wrong. But in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are reconciled with the righteousness of the universe. In the Lord Jesus Christ, every dirty thought, every dirty deed sinks underneath the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's finished. And we have become new minds, new ambitions, new ideas. We have become new. Say new. We have become new persons in our Lord and Savior. We have become reconciled unto Him, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world, that Christ reconciled the whole world unto Himself, not imputing their transgressions. Our trespasses are gone. Jesus Christ accepted the judgment for them, and now the reconciliation. We're reconciled with the Maker of the whole universe. He moves from that verse 19 to verse 20, which is a super thing. He says, and now we're ambassadors for Christ. Isn't that amazing? We move from a condemned one to be a leader. An ambassador represents the king or the prime minister or the president, you see. And so we come from a condemned person to a leader. Aren't you glad for that? That we are changed from a person condemned to death because of sin to a person of high degree and high position and high authority because we have received our reconciliation. So we're ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us that we pray you in Christ's stead, be you reconciled to God. He was talking to a great city of Corinth, a very important city of those days, and a city of merchandise, and a city of culture, that they should be reconciled to God. For he hath made him, the Lord Jesus Christ, to become sin for us, the one who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. Don't you like that? Yeah, that's the way you start your new year. In Christ. Not in your own strength. Now, you might just make a few dozen resolutions. And you might find that before a week's gone, the things crumble at your feet. They discourage you, and you don't know what to do with them. We're not here to make new resolutions. We have a new life. We have a new life in Christ Jesus. We have a new mind in Christ Jesus. We're reconciled with the Creator of the universe through Christ Jesus. And therefore, he hath made him sin for us, the one who knew no sin, that you and I might be the righteousness of God. Can you imagine that? That you and I become the righteousness of God, but you can't leave off those last two words, in him. You're not the righteousness of God in yourself. You're the righteousness of God in Christ. In Christ, we are the righteousness of God. Are you excited about it or not? We thank God on page 7 for a new faith. Now, as we approach this year, that we will be saying quite a few things about it. 1988 will have a lot of surprises for a lot of people, a lot of disappointments for some people. And one of the greatest things that we need in the beginning of this year is a renewal of faith in our hearts. A renewal of faith. In Hebrews 12 and 2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Whatever faith you have within you, he birthed it. And he consummated it. He is the author and the finisher of your faith. You don't need to look anywhere else. You don't need to look into psychology regarding faith, because Christ is the author of it. He birthed it. The faith that you have in your heart was birthed through the new birth. And to everyone, the word says, this is granted at his time of regeneration, that he is granted a measure of faith. Your first measure of faith came in that born again moment, and you said, hey, I believe, and God grants you a measure of faith. And from that moment, that measure of faith becomes seed faith. And it begins to multiply and to grow. How many have more faith now than you had one time, sometime in the past? That's because you have cultivated it. And if you had not cultivated it, you couldn't be able to say that. Now, I do. I feel an increasing of faith on the inside of me. Not with my lips speaking it, and not with my mind conceiving it, but from down through here, rising up within me, says, I trust, I believe, I know, I'm sure, I'm happy, hallelujah, glory to God, the devil's defeated, and Jesus is alive, and I got it, hallelujah. Well, only three of you had it, but that's all right, that's your problem. I am not responsible for what you take or don't take from the Word of God. That's where you have to carry your own responsibility. Some of us would like to be a three-month-old with a mother with a little spoon shoving it in, you know. But God won't do that. God wants you to be a meat eater. And as a meat eater, you go and get what you want, you pull it back and you eat it. And that's what a good meat eater is. And God wants us to eat the meat of the Word. And we can't be babies on pablum. What is spiritual pablum anyway? That's for another time. In the new year, I personally want a renewed faith. Can you say amen? Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. He showed you what faith was there. When that hill had to be climbed, he climbed it. And people couldn't understand why he didn't run away. His own disciples said, why do you go to Jerusalem? You know they want to kill you there. And the Bible says he set his face. He set his face to go to Jerusalem. Why? He knew what was there. But it says here, for the joy that was set before him, he accepted the cross. Well, that could be you and me, you know. For the joy set before us. We know the other side of the hill. We know the other side of the tunnel. We know where the sun shines bright. We know the eternal realms, they are within us. God has spoken to us within us. And we know these things and we're sure of these things. And we're glad that we have been renewed in our faith. So whatever happens to us today, we like Jesus. That with joy, we accept the conditions of today. Now, that takes a renewed faith for some of us. We accept some things, but we accept them with bitterness. We accept some things, but we accept them grumbling at God. Why this? Why that? Why the other? You just have to realize that God knows more about eternity than we do. And God knows more about what's inside of a person than we do. No human being knows precisely what is inside another human being. Oh, but he's such a good person. Why did that happen? What do you know about being a good person? You don't even know your own heart, much less his. It may be your wife, maybe your children. Only God knows the hearts of human beings. And God is a good God. I accept that part. God is a good God. And whatever God is doing, if you love him, whatever is happening for your good. Now, it might take you a little while to see that. But in the golden tomorrow, when we shall see him face to face, we are all going to say, it was good for me. Even Job's going to say, it was good for me. What happened to me? And because it made me a better man. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. He despised the shame. Isn't that something? People say, oh, it's such a shame, you know, to be put on a cross. He despised that. He says, come on, let's get going with this here. We got to fulfill something. Got to fulfill all the promises of God. We got to fulfill all the prophecies that have been spoken concerning me. Let's get moving here. He despised the shame and he sat down. He's on the other side of the hill now. And he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And so there he is exalted. And you know, you'll be the same. If you walk through the problems of this year, the sorrows of this year, the misunderstandings of this year, I want to tell you something. Just on the other side, there's something good there. How many accept that? On the other side, there's something good there. That God can turn around situations that seem bad, and God can make those situations mighty good. And all that God needs is our cooperation. Well, a little more than that, God needs our love. for us to have an understanding, hey, I know God is a good God, and my trust is in Him, and I'm sure that He's going to make this thing turn out just right. In your B portion there, it says, a faith that works for Christ. So this renewed faith that we ask the Lord for at this time of the year, it becomes a faith that works. In James 2:17, even so faith, if it hath not works, it is dead. It is amazing how you don't run on one cylinder. You could have all the faith in the world and sit in the barn till you died. It wouldn't do you any good, you know. And so faith without action is dead. If you say, I have faith, then we say, show us your action. Show us what you're saying, what you're thinking. I'd like to tell you something. Every movement of your eye is either a faith or unbelief. Every time those lips speak, they either speak in faith or unbelief. Every step that you take is either a step of faith or unbelief. Every decision that you come up to, you either make that decision by faith or unbelief. You are faith or not faith. Are you here? And if you think that faith is just something that's big, and all of a sudden something rolls out of you as big as a horse, you're just wrong. Faith is the intimate operations. When I want to check my faith, I just look back for how many decisions I've made and how I made them. If I made a careful decision, I was letting Lester Sumrall do it and not Jesus. Jesus doesn't make careful decisions. He's the wildest thing in the universe. All right. And number two, what is this new faith? It is a new assurance. In John 10:28, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. A new assurance. No doubts. We don't have doubts. We have assurances. I know that I know. I'm sure that I'm sure. I'm positive that I'm positive, and I'm not going to be moved. And all the people said, and that's right. Not only should we have a new assurance, it's not in your lesson there, but I think we should have a new approach to the Word. A new approach to the Word. During this new year, a new approach to the Word. Let's make that Word come alive. Let's get into that Word very strong. Let's use that Word. Every time I read the Bible, it is alive. I just can't help that. I never read the Bible, and it was like a newspaper. Are you here? And I was reading it early this morning, 2 or 3 o'clock. I was reading the Bible, and it was alive. It was alive. You see, I'm going to give you some of that in the morning message today. It was alive. And what we want is a new assurance. Can you say amen? And your number three is a new prayer life. How many can stand that? A joyful prayer life. If you learn to pray in the Spirit, your prayer life will be much easier. If you learn to let the Holy Spirit flow up out of you, when you say, I don't know what to say, well, let the Spirit say it. He knows how to pray. And if you can know how to pray in the Spirit, then you can have a new prayer life. Your point number four on page 8, a new testimony. If there's anything the church needs today, it's that new testimony. In Psalm 119, 171, it says, my lips shall utter praise when thou hast taught me thy statutes. We want to utter praises unto God for all the good things that He teaches us. Job says in chapter 2 and verse 10, but he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God? And we should not receive evil? In all of this, Job did not sin with his lips. A good testimony that we should have in our hearts toward God. All right, so let's take an inventory. It's a time of the year to take an inventory of our spiritual lives to see if we have grown, see if we have increased, if we have been what God wants us to be. And I believe if we will do that, that we can make this new year a good year. How many want it to be a good year? Praise God. How many are going to make it a good year? Hallelujah. If you wake up every morning and say, listen to me, Mr. Day, I don't mean maybe, get with it now. If you're a salesman, look in the mirror, smile and shave and say, I'm looking at the best salesman in the country. God help everybody, I'm going to sell you something. Can you say amen? Amen. If you're a preacher, say the same thing. Father, we thank you and we love you and we appreciate you. And we ask you that as we face a new year, let something new come inside of us. Not the old, but the new. And for your blessings, we thank you. And all the people said, give the Lord a hand, everybody. Glory.